Good morning. My name is Mark Phillips, one of the pastors of Highlands Presbyterian Church, Harare, Zimbabwe. Today is Easter Friday 2020. Our readings today come from John chapter 19. Jesus has already been arrested. He has been falsely accused, ridiculed, slapped, viciously whipped. We pick up the story in verse 14. It was the day of preparation of Passover week, about the sixth hour. "Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews, but they shouted, "Take him away, take him away, crucify him." "Shall I crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the chief priests answered. Finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified. So the soldiers took charge of Jesus, carrying his own cross. He went to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. Here they crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side and Jesus in the middle. Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. The chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews, but that this man claimed to be the King of the Jews." Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scriptures would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it and put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Now it was the day of preparation, and the next day was to be a special Sabbath. Because the Jews did not want the bodies left on the crosses during the Sabbath, they asked Pilate to have their legs broken and the bodies taken down. The soldiers therefore came and broke the legs of the first man who had been crucified with Jesus, and then those of the other. But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. The man who saw this has given testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows that he tells the truth, and he testifies so that you also may believe. These things happen so that the scriptures would be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And, as another scripture says, they will look on the one they have pierced. Last week, we looked at Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead and Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, Palm Sunday. In looking mainly at chapters 11 and 12 of John, we saw that everything Jesus did was for the good of everyone, that they might believe. Believe that Jesus is the Son of God and the Christ, the Messiah, the one sent to save us. Jesus proclaimed, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live even when they die." Do you believe this? Do you believe this? Jesus asks. John's writings are quite different from the other Gospels. He started by reminding us that in the beginning Jesus was with God and that Jesus is God and that he created all things. And then he came to earth in the flesh. The mighty Creator became a part of his creation. He limited himself by time and space, susceptible to aging, suffering, and death. He did this out of his great love for you and me. He came to rescue and save those who were lost and to give the gift of eternal life. John does not so much record the life of Jesus like Matthew, Mark, and Luke. He carefully selects some of Jesus' teachings and miracles as a powerful argument that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, the only source of eternal life. John says in John chapter 20, Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these, that which are recorded, are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. John, on several occasions, points out how Jesus fulfills Old Testament prophecy. On Palm Sunday, as Jesus entered into Jerusalem, those who had gathered shouted out scripture prophesied hundreds of years before in the book of Zechariah. Rejoice greatly. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey. Do not be afraid. Jesus, your God, is humble and gentle. He comes to you unthreateningly on a donkey to take your sin and give you his righteousness in its place, to give you free salvation that you could never earn. There is nothing to fear in Jesus. Again, the Old Testament prophet Isaiah spoke of Jesus and his death nearly 700 years before in Isaiah 53. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. In the Old Testament, people offered animals as sacrifices for their sin. Blood was shed to cover their sin. Here, the sinless Son of God offers himself as the perfect sacrificial lamb to shed his blood to cover our sins once and for all. God knew our condition. All had strayed from him and rejected him, rebelled against our Creator, revolted against him, fallen to perverse ways and depravity. And God sent his Son to take all of that sin upon himself and to be a sacrifice for us. Who would believe that God would choose to save the world through a humble, suffering servant rather than a glorious, conquering king? The Messiah's strength is shown in his humility, his selflessness, his sacrifice, his mercy, his grace, and his love. God, being in very nature love and a complete unity in himself, enjoying perfect relationship as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, wanted to share what he had. And so he created man, male and female he created them. And for a while, they shared that perfect relationship in his perfect creation. But then, tempted by God's enemy Satan, mankind rejected God and rebelled and decided to go their own way. God had declared that the result of the created rejecting the Creator was death. But God had a plan to save that which he loved the most, you and me. Rather than demanding our death, he allowed death into his perfect creation so that he could come and die for us, paying the penalty we deserved. It was the only way. And what a terrible death he endured for us. Killed by those he came to save. We sinned against him, and he then gave himself to us to kill him in our place. The debt was paid, the penalty was served. What kind of a God is this? This is not the story of what we have to do for God. This is the story of what God has done for us. Surely that demands a response. Pilate said, "Don't you realize I have power either to free you or to crucify you?" Jesus answered, "You would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above." Let us pray. Father, you had a plan from the beginning. In the Garden of Eden, we did not trust you. We did not trust your plan. When tempted through our own desires, through our selfishness and pride and arrogance, we decided to believe your enemy and to trust in ourselves. Once again, this Easter, we face ourselves before you. Will we trust you? Will we love you more than we love ourselves? Father, we believe. Help our unbelief. We trust. Help our distrust. We love. Help us to learn how to love you. Jesus, you were selfless. You were humble. You sacrificed yourself for us to pay the price for our wrongs. We wronged you, and yet you paid our debt. Thank you for your incredible grace and mercy. There is no God like you. There is no God but you. We know you are reaching out to us today and every day. Some of us still fear and shrink back. Some of us are ashamed of the things we have done. Some of us feel we are unworthy of your love. And you would tell us, no, there is nothing to fear, that you took our shame, and that we are made in your image and you love us perfectly despite our failings and weaknesses. You know us intimately. You know we are weak, and that is why you came. Jesus, we can only imagine what you endured for us. There is no distance too far that you would not have traveled, no price too high that you would not have paid. That is how much we mean to you. We are covered by your blood, free. It is done. It is finished. Yes, today we remember our sin that put you on the cross. But what would you have us remember? Simply that you love us, that we are free of all guilt and shame, free to fully love you and to fully live. You would tell us not to dwell on our sin. You already carried our sin to the cross and you defeated sin and death on our behalf. Your word tells us you do not remember our sin. It is not the nails that held you to the cross, it was your love. You would tell us to dwell then on you and new life in you. So, Jesus says, bring your shame and guilt to the foot of the cross and leave it there. Do not carry it one moment longer. Today, Jesus, you would have us remember your love. It is your love that covers us, that reaches out to us and to the ends of the earth, that reaches out to everyone. What would you have us do today, Jesus? You would have us reflect, to consider where we are before you. Are we living lives trusting you? Or are we still trusting our own ways, our own wisdom, our own desires? You would ask us a simple question. Do you love me? Do you believe? Thank you for giving us peace. Surely you are the Son of God.
On the day that death surrendered to the mighty cross of Jesus Christ, the earth would shake beneath the weight of darkened skies. On his brow, a crown of sorrow for a king whose weakness was our strength. No word he spoke, his love was shown for all to see. All the cross of Jesus Christ is the reason I'm alive, for his blood has set me free.
comes in glory to reveal the fullness of